let's go to one of the Windsors. And I don't mean Queen Elizabeth or Prince Charles. I mean Dr. Jay Sutay, who joins us in, I always forget, South Windsor, Connecticut?
Well, formerly of South Windsor. I am now a resident of Vernon, Connecticut, town over.
Hey, Vern.
Yeah, my girlfriend and I bought a lovely home out here. We moved in 3 weeks ago. So it's very nice. I'm outside on my back deck
with
overlooking
Rodney.
Rodney had to be inside because he barks at shadows and you don't need that business.
Yeah.
So shadows and reflections. Like if you take out a pan that's stainless steel and it reflects on the ceiling, he'll have none of that.
I should mention that Dr. Jay Sutay is the hardest working pediatrician in comedy. Do you take Rodney to the vet or do you just service him? Do you do the
oil
changes?
Oh, no. He goes to the vet. No. No. In fact, he's got an appointment November 13th, I believe, his yearly. He'll be, he's approaching his, he just turned 3, so we go in usually November, December. Apparently, he's got 5 or 6 shots he's got to get.
But can't you do that?
What, I stock distemper shots in my pediatrics office?
But
canine flu vaccines?
Can't you just pick them up?
Oh, I'm sure if I went to the vet and picked them up, he'd let me give them. But why would I want to do that to my boy?
Yeah, what's that tapping sound?
Oh, that's me. Sorry, I'll stop.
What is it?
Just a nice little mahogany pipe that I took a puff off of, that's all.
Ah, very dignified.
Like
Sherlock Holmes.
It makes me feel like that, but I do not have one that has a bend in it. It's a straight mm-hmm. one. It's beautiful. It's right. very fine quality.
A pipe. It makes you smart. I'm sure you're smoking
think?
Some of the finest tobacco
yeah.
you can buy.
There's plenty of tobacco in there.
Yeah. And is that medicinal tobacco?
It's medicinal tobacco because I went back to work today after being off for 10 days. And let me tell you, one day is enough.
Now,
I don't want to quote Sebastian Maniscalco, man, but the week I had today, you know, that's what it felt like. I mean, I take days off and that doesn't mean that things stop pouring onto my desk. I just come back. It takes me 2.5 days to get caught up.
Well, you better get caught up. You just paid for a wedding.
Yeah, I did. I did. She's we just had her 1 month anniversary and, you know, we were able to get her now husband onto her. She's a school teacher, so school teachers, board of eds, they get good medical insurance like forever. Mm-hmm. So we were able to, you know, we had a little party putting Rick on the good insurance, taking him off of Obamacare. So a little progress there.
Obamacare, their business model. I was just reading about this in the New York Times.
My other daughter's on Obamacare. God bless Obamacare.
Yeah, God bless it, but 25% of the claims are rejected.
See, and that just makes more work for people that got enough on their minds. That's why Medicare for All just makes sense. Just don't screw the doctors, man. We went to school for a long goddamn time.
Well, the doctors
sacrificed some of my the best years of my life from the age of 22 to 29. I sacrificed by going to medical school and doing my residency where I made nothing and then graduated with debt. But I'm far enough out, so the bitterness is gone. But I still had to get through all of that stuff to get where I am now. So, you know, I don't know why. But in the business model of health insurers now is the only part of the model that generates income is the people who are seeing patients. So I'm basically, you know, the worker bee down in the factory while everything kind of flows upstream now. Where it used to be the other way around. So it's a big adjustment.
Yeah. You know, the AMA, the American Medical Association, was against Medicare. They fought it.
Mm-hmm.
And I suspect that if doctors really wanted Medicare for All, we could have it.
Yeah. Well, I think doctors are tired of working for health insurers, corporations, and if we're going to have work for a corporation, let's make it the same for everybody.
Yeah, don't they make the doctors complicit in this? Don't they kind of like give them stock in the health insurance companies and the hospitals? So they,
I mean, we can buy stock. We can buy stock in our corporate entity, but they don't give stuff away. No, they don't give it away. But it is, you know, it's all, listen, it's It's horrible what's happening to the medical profession. I'm sad that I'm in my mid-50s and will probably not live long enough for doctors to start making money again. But they will again someday. Something will have to change. Otherwise, you're not going to see the best and the brightest go into medical school just to graduate and put up with what is now the healthcare system.
But, you know, if doctors can't cure the healthcare system, what can they cure? It really is...
Right. Right. Well, you know what's going to happen? It's all going to be computers and 3D imaging, you know.
Right.
You're going to be able to get your body scanned, and you're going to give a blood test, and somebody's going to suck on your dick and taste your semen, and they're going to give you a printout, and they're going to tell you exactly what's happening, what's going to happen, when it's going to happen. They're going to know everything. So,
right.
You know, they got to get fluids from everywhere.
Right. By the way, one of my sons came up with a variation on a great joke. Dom Herrera used to tell this.
Yes.
It probably still tells this joke. My doctor called me, said I need a stool sample, a blood sample, and a semen sample. So I sent him my sheets, or I sent him my underwear. That's an old joke,
right?
Sent him
my underwear. Yes, that's
old funny. Joke. Well, one of my sons is a comedy genius. I mean, he really is. It's just phenomenal. And he knew that joke, and he said to me, my doctor called, he said, I need a semen sample, a blood sample, and a stool sample, so I sent him a stool sample.
Oh, that's a good one. That's a good one.
Hey, wow. You know.
Yeah. That was funny.
He's in his
I like
mid-20s.
That one. I think we might have said. I think you may have told me that one before, but I forgot the.
I'm telling
you. I know the first part, but I forgot how your son had kicked it up.
I was so proud of him. I called.
You
Dom.
Should be.
Yeah, I called Dom. So, yeah, it just seems like the doctors should speak up. You know, the nurses.
The doctors don't have time to speak up because patients are dependent upon us being there 4 or 5 days a week to take care of them.
Yeah,
you know, it's
yeah,
real.
Yeah.
I mean, but 26 years I've been doing this. I am in my heart an activist who would love to do this, but I got to make money. And the only way I make money is by seeing patients. And honestly, that's what I was taught and trained how to do.
Right.
I don't know how to do all this other stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, but about 55,000 Americans die every year because they don't have health insurance or they're underinsured.
Right.
So it
but
seems to
if
me.
If you see some of these people at Trump rallies, though, do we really need to provide them health care? I think they're going to take care of things on their own just by, you know, one finger, one digit, one limb at a time, I think. Can't we just all give them harmonica lessons and see what shakes from that? But.
Yeah, it's true. Well, let me ask you, I don't want to talk about patients. I should mention that Dr. Jay Sutay, the hardest working pediatrician in comedy, is a semifinalist in world's funniest comic.
Connecticut, not the world.
You stepped on my joke.
Oh, I'm sorry.
World's funniest comic in Connecticut.
There you go.
It's,
there you go.
What is it? The funniest comic in Connecticut?
Yeah, it's like this contest has been an albatross for me. I've been in it a number of times. I've been in the finals 3 times. I have finished 3rd all 3 times. I made it to the finals. So now we're in the semifinals. It started with 64 comics. We are down to 2 groups of 5. So 10 comics.
The Westport Treehouse this Saturday at the Westport, Connecticut Treehouse.
Treehousecomedy.com.
What time does the show start?
Show starts at 8, and then the semifinal rounds are this Saturday, the 26th, the following Saturday, which I believe is the 2nd, and then if I make it to the finals, that it will be on the 9th, all in Westport Treehouse Comedy.
Fantastic.
But the point is, we're down to 10, okay?
And that's impressive.
5 in my group. 3 are going home this weekend, so we see what happens. And they're all great comics, you know. And let me tell you, there are a couple of ringers there that aren't even from Connecticut. So I guess the contest should be called Funniest Comic in Connecticut at this moment.
Well, you better get their birth certificate. Why don't you demand to see their birth
certificate? I know. Half of them are from different states. I think it bastardizes the contest. But whatever. I welcome competition.
You know, I was driving through Connecticut. Ralph Nader has the Tort Museum in Weston, Connecticut.
Up in Litchfield, right. Yeah. Litchfield County, yeah.
Are there any ugly parts of Connecticut?
Not this time of year. I tell you, the house that I'm living in now, that we moved in 3 weeks ago, is right in the middle of gigantic trees that are as tall as you could see. I'm looking right off my back porch now, past my gazebo. I just see different colored leaves, and it's just beautiful. It is. There are beautiful parts of this state, but it's hard to drive around in it. That's probably the worst part, and the taxes will kill you.
Yeah, so, why is it hard to drive around?
There's always construction. You can't get through Hartford in the amount of time that your Waze is telling you. Thank God it calculates in traffic jams, but when you see one that you're going to be stuck for 10 minutes trying to go a half a mile, that's never happy.
Okay. Well,
Connecticut, lots of construction on the highways. We get Obama bucks, Trump bucks, whatever bucks come, they're always doing something on the highways in Connecticut.
Right. So we do listener questions.
Oh, yeah. You mentioned that.
Yeah. And we have a listener question for...
Do we have a theme? Do we have a theme song for listener questions? I say we get someone on it.
Somebody's got to get on it. Somebody's got to get on it. The worse, the better. That's what I always say.
I heard the last one. It meets your standards.
Yeah. The one for Howie Klein?
Yeah.
Yeah. Listen, we have a new one for Howie Klein. So if anybody wants to do a theme song for listener questions and it's bad, please send it in. Or good.
Yeah.
But we wouldn't know the difference. So we have a serious listener question. He says that he has found, this is serious now, so he has found a lump underneath his arm, in his armpit.
Yep.
He wants to go look at it. He wants a doctor to look at it, but he's afraid that if it's serious, he will not qualify for Obamacare because he's about to sign up for health insurance. Well, so what should he do? He said, should I do?
There's a number of questions that I will pose, and perhaps we can get these answers. But I need to know whether it hurts. Does it hurt when you try to wiggle it? Is it tender? Is it painful? Is it getting bigger? Is it soft and squishy? Is it hard to the touch? There's lots of things it could be. What I see a lot in pediatrics is enlarged lymph nodes under the armpit that almost certainly are due to getting a scratch from a cat on their arms. You get a scratch on your arm, the lymph nodes of the arm drain through the armpit and help to rid the body of infection. And one of the more common things in my area to see an armpit lymph node enlarge is cat scratch. Bacterial infection in the lymph node in the armpit gets a big, red, swollen. It could be as simple as a skin abscess if it's superficial. If it's deeper, it could be a lymph node. And, I don't mean to scare the person, but, you can get lymph nodes that enlarge that are cancer. And usually those are lymph nodes that grow slowly and keep getting bigger. But lymph nodes that are responding to an infection or a cat scratch or something like that, usually we get enlarged over 7 to 10 days as the body's trying to fight the infection. And then when the skin infection goes away, the lymph node gets smaller and goes back to normal size. So if it's red, swollen, tender to the touch, if they have a fever, those things all point towards infection. And I would not wait 1 second to go have it looked at.
But can you be denied health care if you have a pre-existing condition?
Well, if you have an armpit abscess that gets better and drains and you're fine, then that's not going to happen again. It turns out that it's some kind of a lymphoma or something. Well, I suppose we don't have pre-existing conditions anymore. So it shouldn't be an issue. It shouldn't be an issue.
Right. You cannot be denied health insurance if you have a pre-existing condition.
And they can't jack you up. But what they're trying to do is change that. So, if you do have certain pre-existing conditions, you pay a higher premium, and that's not what Mr. Obama wrote up.
Right. I think you win the election running on Medicare for All. I can't imagine anything more important then
something that affects every single person in this country in the same way. You'd think we could all get behind it, don't you?
We've been brainwashed. I was just talking to somebody who I really respect, and he's saying, how are you going to put the health insurance companies out of business? And I said, well, you can't, I guess you can't outlaw.
I got an idea for them. How about you call, they start giving out marriage insurance, okay? Marriage doesn't last. It pays for all the divorce and the kids' college and everything else. It'll be a booming business. Or pregnancy insurance. When you have a baby and decide that you're going to deliver a baby, that insurance company, poor bastards, they got to take on everything you ever did bad to your body and hope that you still produce a healthy baby. Because if you don't, then somebody's going to pay for it, right? So why not have pregnancy insurance that, you know, say your baby's ugly and is going to need some plastic surgery. That pregnancy insurance will you know, tighten up that nose and that little turkey neck they got going on there. And we can insure other things. That's what I'm saying.
Yes.
Okay. They will survive, but we've got to change the path. They can't. People's health, they're holding our health hostage is what they're doing. And it's pissing off doctors. And then before you know it, no one's going to want to go to med school except for the kids that you know, couldn't figure out how to work a computer.
Yeah.
It's frustrating to watch 26 years of just watching. I would love to someday, you know, look back, write a book about my 26 years, because the only reason we're in the trouble we're in now is they changed how they pay doctors again. They did it in 93 when I started, and then now they're changing it back to something else that everybody who changed their way of practicing to adjust to the way we were paid from 93 to 2013. Now the gears are shifting because the insurance company said, well, we're going to pay you based on this instead of that. And then everybody's got to shuffle to realign things, or we're not able to be profitable. And it's just plain.
Do you understand how you get paid? Do you understand the billing process? Do you understand how hospitals?
I used to. When I had my practice, I would get statements. Now I'm paid based on, you know, how much of my schedule is filled for the day, patient satisfaction surveys, productivity, which is measured in something called an RVU, a relative value unit. So I'm an RVU collector.
And the people running these health insurance companies, if 25% of the claims are turned down,
we're spinning a lot of wheels and spending a lot of money and not producing a goddamn thing.
Are those doctors turning down these claims?
Oh, well, it's initially not doctors, but you go up the food chain. They have their review people, and eventually, if you keep appealing it, it'll go up to a doctor, usually the insurance company's medical director, who makes the final decision. But that can take you 6 months.
So who has the authority? It's just a bureaucrat saying we're not approving this treatment?
They're looking at what the contract is on the health insurance plan that you signed up for. And if this is outside of that, they feel there's no, you know, and every insurance plan for every different big company is written up differently. So there's no continuity to it. So half of the time, people don't even know what they have. If we had one insurance that compensated and was efficient and paid the providers of care well, that's all we would need. And everybody would have care.
It's why aren't we revolting?
Because we're too goddamn busy doing podcasts. No, I'm just kidding.
No, you're right.
We're doing 5-hour podcasts twice a week. That's why we're not getting anything done.
Well, we are literally being murdered by these greedy corporatists.
Right. And now you got them on both sides. The doctors are owned by corporations. All the drug companies are owned by corporations. And it's just this big fucking carnivorous orgy of money that they're all churning up for themselves.
Yep. And then you have people like Joe Biden, who takes money from the health insurance companies and the hospital companies. And Pete Buttigieg. We had Alex Koch on from Sludge on Tuesday. And he has revealed that Mayor Pete is taking money from health insurance lobbyists, and suddenly it's Medicare.
He's
for
the most
some.
Republican Democrat in the group. That's all I'm saying. Yeah. But I like him. I like his spark. I think he's fine. I think he's going to be all right. But he's a little green. But I like him. I like him.
I don't. I think he's a monster. I think Biden's a monster.
I don't think he's a monster.
I think he's a monster.
Biden, I agree with you on. I mean, I'm a Bernie guy. I'm going to go Bernie. I'm going to go Democrat. I'm going to see that they throw us up somebody that can win this time. That's all I'm hoping for.
I'll let you go. But if you can't give us Medicare for all and you're a Democrat, get the F out of my party.
Off the train.
Get off my.
You don't need them.
Get out of here.
I agree with you. I've heard you say that before, and I sometimes will beat my horn and thrust my fist into the air.
Yeah, I mean, you're more of a problem than Mitch McConnell is. If you're a Democrat, if you're Joe Biden or Mayor Pete, saying, you know, you're for affordable health insurance or affordable health care, get out of my party. I don't want affordable health care. I want free health care.
Right. Yeah. And every place else in the world can pull it off.
Yeah. And there's money. We have the money. We have the money.
If we weren't spending all the time rejecting 45% of the claims, right?
Yeah.
Those are people collecting salaries, and you're going up 3-4 different levels. It takes 6 months to do. That's just keeping the money flowing.
Yeah. At some point, it's the Hannah Arendt talks about the banality of evil with the Nazis, where it's the bureaucracy and it's layered. So nobody really can feel like they're the one responsible for the final solution.
Right.
You're just a cog in the wheel. If you work for these health insurance companies, it's the banality of evil. You're just part of the process, but you're a
monster. I'm turning into the bad guy.
Yeah, you're a monster. All right, Dr. J. Sutay, hardest working, and that cough, you should get that looked at.
Yeah, I know.
Is it your pipe?
Forget about that. No, I just had a little sip of beer and went down the wrong pipe. I was just finishing up. I was killing the can while you were talking.
Dr. J. Sutay is the hardest working pediatrician in comedy. This Saturday night, he will be at the Treehouse in Westport, Connecticut. He's a semi-finalist in Funniest Comic in Connecticut. What's first prize? A trip out of Connecticut?
It means you got to stay here and perform in shows for paid gigs. And also there's a cash amount, which would be very nice to supplement my other salary as a pediatrician. So audience votes do count. So if there are any people out there in the Westport area, go to treehousecomedy.com and come and help me out on the 26th, Saturday.
Are you competitive?
I went to med school. I would say I'm competitive, sure.
With yourself?
Not pathologically.
Or
not, with myself, mostly. As a comedian, I'm only competitive with myself.
But are you competitive with other doctors? I mean, in order to get to medical school?
I mean, there are doctors that you just have a lower opinion of because of their abilities. And I would say, I mean, all doctors aren't created equal.
Right. Hey, did you use my joke?
Yes, I did. And let me tell you, I have used it every time I've gotten the opportunity since. I did not use it at my daughter's wedding. Okay.
Yeah.
I was forbidden to. And, but I did, I've done it in my act, and I'll tell you, it's become an integral part. I like it. It gets a huge, huge laugh. And then I talk about the brother. I've expanded on it a little bit, too. So it's funny. It's really come out to be one of my favorite jokes to tell because they completely caught by surprise by it.
All right. I love you, buddy. Stay on the line.
I love you, too, David Feldman. You be well.
All right. Stay on the line for one quick second.